Archie and Cornell versus Pop Warner Little Scholars.
Good afternoon, Your Honors. Bob Finnerty. And may it please the court, I'd like to reserve 2 minutes for a rebuttal.
Okay, please watch your time.
Thank you, Your Honor. Your Honors, I believe that all of us would agree that children are our most precious resources, that they should be protected, and of course, their brains should be protected. For some reason, the trial court in our case got hung up on the belief that there had to be actual medical records, medical evidence of a concussion before we could prove that there was any.
Well, I didn't necessarily read him to get hung up on that. What I saw the district court doing was applying the Daubert standards for the admissibility of expert testimony. And he said your experts had done a good job of showing that there was a possibility of causation, but they had not excluded a whole bunch of other potential causes. What's your response to that?
Well, we could focus on those because those whole bunch of other potential causes were simply Paul participated 1 year in high school wrestling. That's the only other cause with respect to Paul, other than participating as a child in not full contact karate. Karate that didn't involve any blows to the head whatsoever.
But counsel, this isn't a case where the direct cause of the deaths was brain injury. This was a case where you're alleging that brain injury caused by Pop Warner was responsible for a car accident that tragically resulted in the death of one of your clients and in the second case caused suicide by gunshot. And so it's different than a circumstance where there had been testimony that this was directly caused by brain trauma. So that may have been one of the things that the trial judge was getting at, because it's different than just a very direct cause. And I think that's where the district court had a Daubert problem.
I think that problem probably arose because the district court was hung up on the belief that there was not, in fact, brain injury or brain trauma. I think that...
Well, they had the evidence of CTE stage one, and I didn't see anyone disputing that that's what the autopsies showed.
Correct, Your Honor. So what all of the experts stated from both sides was that these two young men both suffered brain injury, brain trauma, from their repetitive subconcussive contact in their participation of football. So both sides agreed that these young men suffered brain injury as a result of their participation in Pop Warner football. And to answer Judge Bennett's question, I do believe it's a direct response, because the experts also all agreed that behavioral problems, aggression, impulsivity, and suicide is a direct response to the types of brain injuries that these two young men suffered.
Can be. Not is, can be.
Well, one of the things that we all have to struggle with while we're trying to put forth policy and protect our youth is the fact that this is new and evolving science. But that should not in any way, stretch, or form result in...
Counsel, I'll tell you what my most basic problem with your case is, that your two experts' testimonies strike me as very, very similar to what was in Kumho Tire. Sort of, I know it when I see it. One talked about Cartesian and Aristotelian logic. One talked about logic, but neither of them explained the mechanism why in these two cases, why even given brain injury caused by Pop Warner football, that was the cause of either the suicide or the car accident. Tell me why this case is different than Kumho Tire, where the Supreme Court, in my view, rejected that kind of expert analysis.
Because this expert analysis actually went to the issue of the area of the brains that were damaged. With respect to Paul, for instance, the frontal lobe was the area that was damaged. And that area has been consistently held to be an area which results in mood disorders and suicidal ideations. So I don't think we're limited by Kumho. I think that if we're going to talk about policy...
But again, that answer seems to say, yes, there's a possible causal link, but it doesn't show that there's a substantial causal link. I mean, the suicides occur for a whole variety of reasons. And I didn't see the expert... Yes, it's possible, but I didn't see the expert come in and say, but there's also all these other potential reasons and I'm going to rule them out.
Well, that's also an issue that it was of concern to us, because when we went to argue the case, we immediately addressed the issue that we would be prepared to have admissibility hearings with respect to these experts if there was any concerns that the court had. But the court just dismissed that and went straight to, there's no evidence of actual concussions, therefore I don't believe that there's brain.
Well, but the court said that as an alternative. I mean, I'm reading for, and I'm not sure how to pronounce his name, but Dr. Marikangas's deposition. And he's asked, so you can't say with a degree of certainty at ER 2791 that the behavior that led to this accident was a result of repetitive injury. I did not say that. Okay, I said what I said could be. Yes, may have been related. So, I mean, that's what your expert said, may have been related, and later getting to it, it's based on Aristotelian and Cartesian logic, although I may have him and the other expert mixed up on that. But why is that enough?
Well, don't you think that that was an error with respect to the questioning as opposed to the answer? Cartesian logic is something that we all engage in on a daily basis. It takes into consideration the rational world around us and the mathematics involved in
that. But wait, so are you saying that that's an expert can base his expert testimony on Cartesian logic and that's admissible?
I'm
confused.
I certainly think every expert should base his or her opinion on logic. And Cartesian logic is not something that's
okay,
out of the ordinary.
Fair enough that they should be logical, but I don't think that that can be the sole basis. There has to be a scientific basis, and that seems to be what's missing here. Like, we're not saying you can't use Cartesian logic, but we're saying that's not in and of itself sufficient. There has to be some other scientific basis, and where is that?
So the scientific basis that we have and that was proffered is the fact that the overwhelming majority of individuals who have been studied, who have been found to have CTE, have mood, impulsivity, aggression, and suicidal issues.
Have they committed suicide? Are the majority of individuals who play Pop Warner as children, do the majority of them commit suicide when they hit their 20s?
Well, we don't know that right now because their brains haven't been studied after the fact to determine whether or not they actually
suffered. There's no study showing that most children who play Pop Warner kill themselves in their 20s.
Okay, but that's the reverse.
Well, I'm just asking, is there any such study?
There is not yet.
Is there a study of persons who have killed themselves in their 20s? And to the extent they've done brain scans, that the majority of them had CTE and had played Pop Warner football? Is there any study of that sort?
The overwhelming study, Your Honor, that studied people who have CTE connected their CTE with suicidal ideations.
And how many of them committed suicide?
Yes.
How many of them? What percentage of those people studied committed suicide?
Over 50% of them made efforts to commit suicide.
Wait, how do you even know that? Over 50% of who? What are you saying?
And how did you get an autopsy while they were still alive?
We didn't.
Problematic.
Well, that's why I was questioning about your 50% figure, because you would only know if they had CT after they died. So how can you backtrack that to say, so I don't know what you're saying.
So I understand, and there's no doubt that we know we're up against something. The NFL, collegiate football, tackle football, It's a multi-billion dollar business. So right now in our country, football owns 2 days of our week, NFL on Sunday, collegiate on Saturday. The Pop Warner claims that it's out there trying to protect youth and help them develop. In 2010, Pop Warner admitted that they had a problem with respect to brain damage and concussions. They said that through new protocol and new techniques, they had reduced the amount of concussions by 76% in practice. Well, does that mean that before these protocols were introduced, that they were 76% more dangerous, or that they had an unreasonable number of concussions happening?
Okay, all of that goes to, I believe that there's a problem here. The question isn't whether there is a potential problem. The question is whether your specific clients, the plaintiffs here, whether their deaths were caused by CTE, and that CTE was caused by Pop Warner football. It's not, no one's doubting that it's a potential theory. So you just got to do more than that. And I didn't see that. I've been asking what your expert said, and I don't think I've gotten an answer yet in 12 minutes.
Oh, I'm sorry if you didn't. I'll give you one right now. So Julian Bales, who is the expert for the defense and on the board of Pop Warner, testified that the types of emotional distress that occurs as a result of these subconcussive and concussive hits, whether or not they're medically documented or not, it's accepted that with every game, these children sustain some level of brain trauma and or brain injury. So Julian Bales said that suicide has been associated and connected with CTE and the very brain trauma. You're shaking your head.
I'm not. I guess my point is I'm not disagreeing with that. I don't think anybody's disagreeing with that. The question is that what happened here? Because the question here is, does every suicide by someone who played Pop Warner and commits suicide 10 years later, is that enough in and of itself? And I don't think it is. And I don't think your experts did more. They've got to show something more than Pop Warner suicide. There's got to be an extra causation element there. And I'm asking yet again for that specific causation. I think you're just going back to the general statements, and I understand the difficulty of your case, but the general statements aren't enough.
Do you want to save some time for a rebuttal? You're down to about 2 minutes.
Yes, I wanted to save 2 minutes, but I would like to address Judge Nelson's comment.
Fine, your time.
I'm sorry?
I said it is your time.
Okay. I do think that Julian Bales connected CTE and subconcussive brain injury with suicidal ideations. I don't think that's not a question. So it has happened at every step of the way that there has been a connection. And with that, I'll reserve my remaining time.
All right. We'll hear from the other side. You're still on mute.
My apologies. Thank you, Your Honors. I think the court is right on the issue. I think you're focusing on the correct issue and the concerns of Judge Gutierrez. What we're talking about is, what is a substantial factor? And as Judge Gutierrez, I believe, correctly concluded, plaintiff's experts didn't make the substantial factor connection between the suicide of Tyler Cornell at age 25 and the unfortunate motorcycle death of Paul Bright Jr. at age 24.
If I understand Mr. Finnerty correctly, he's saying it's undisputed that playing Pop Warner can cause brain injuries, CTE, and that CTE has been closely connected with suicidal ideation and other self-destructive behaviors. And here we have two individuals who played Pop Warner and then went on to develop self-destructive behaviors, and a subsequent autopsy showed they had CTE. So why isn't that enough?
What's lacking, Your Honor, is any ability to tie CTE to Pop Warner. For purposes of the motion, Judge Gutierrez says, I'll give you general causation, without finding that, without finding that they actually suffered brain injury playing Pop Warner.
Wait, I wanted to go back to your answer. You're saying that the link that's missing here is the connection to Pop Warner football and the CTE?
There's two links. One we're taking as a given for purposes of this argument. For purposes of this argument, we're saying you've got general causation. We're saying that you can get CTE playing youth football. We're accepting that as a general proposition. That's Judge Gutierrez's ruling. Without actually finding that, he was very clear that he was not making the finding that these young men actually suffered CTE or brain injury. He's just saying, for purposes of argument, you can get that. The second connection, as the court correctly focused on earlier, was tying the self-destructive behavior some 10 or more years later to CTE and
well,
to
but
Pop
which one
football.
Is, in your opinion, which of those connections is lacking here?
Well, they're both lacking. The concessions you find are that, yes, there's an association between CTE and football.
Because I thought your experts had testified, or one of your experts had testified, that playing Pop Warner football could cause CTE.
Could. Playing any football could. Any contact sport could. The other element of testimony is you don't have to have a particular concussion. We don't know what the floor is. Any contact could cause brain injury, could cause CTE. And something else important to note about CTE, and this is in Judge Gutierrez's decision, he focused on this as well, it's tau protein in the brain, which is a normal substance in the brain. This is something that plaintiff's experts actually testified about as well. Dr. Harris, plaintiff's pathologist, testified that tau protein is a normal substance in the brain. And what we're talking about with CTE is an accumulation of tau protein in an abnormal way. And what's not understood is the complete mechanism of that. There are studies that show folks that have tau protein, CTE, that have functioned quite fine. Postmortem study shows CTE, no behavioral issue. And so the correlation isn't quite there. When we examined Dr. Marikangas at deposition, he conceded that he could not connect the death of Paul Bright Jr. or the death of Tyler Cornell to playing Pop Warner football. Dr. Harris is even clearer.
But let me back up. He said that, but was it because of the first connection between Pop Warner and CTE, or because of the second connection between CTE and the deaths?
I think both. Dr. Marikangas is a psychiatrist, so he focuses more on behavior, but I think he bridged into both. But if you want to talk about the CTE formation, Dr. Harris, Brent Harris, the plaintiff's pathologist, was very clear. I put the question to him directly, and he very clearly stated he cannot tell you when a CTE finding originated. He can't tell you that the CTE found in Paul Bright Jr.'s brain or in Tyler Cornell's brain originated at a particular point in time.
Okay, counsel, I want to go back to your characterization of Dr. Marikangas's testimony, because I'm looking at 2794 of the record. Is it your opinion that the years that Tyler Cornell played youth football caused him to commit suicide? Answer, I think it was a substantial contributing factor as opposed to a cause. So there may not have been, in Daubert, a basis for that, but he did say that playing Pop Warner was a substantial contributing factor in the suicide.
He did say that. But, and I don't have the quote here, I'm looking for it. He says a few other things when you start drilling down on him.
Well, he also says he didn't have an opinion on whether anything else in the course of Tyler Cornell's life caused him to sustain the chronic traumatic encephalopathy.
Correct. May I continue?
Please.
I'm happy to answer questions, but there are a couple of other things I wanted to touch on. And so we get to, you know, what's a substantial factor? The law in California, the jury charge for substantial factor covers that conduct is not a substantial factor if the same harm would have occurred without the conduct. And that's what we've got here. We've got not a direct line between, okay, you played football and you got CTE and CTE did something. It's you played football, you got CTE, we're conceding that happened for purposes of this argument, and then somebody shoots themselves some 10 plus years later. Somebody dies in a motorcycle accident some 10 plus years later. And the experts all testified that this kind of behavior, self-destructive behavior, can happen without brain damage. It's statistically a higher probability in the mid-20s for a young man than at any other point in his life. But isn't it true
that CTE would have increased those chances?
That's a theory. There are no studies that show that. It's a theory.
On either one, either destructive behavior that could have led to taking unreasonable risks or to suicide. There's no studies.
That's correct. It's associated with mood, but there's a lot of other things that come up in those studies. For example, if you start talking about the things that Dr. Amalu talks about, you know, going back to his study of Mike Webster, the Pittsburgh Steeler, who didn't die from suicide. He died from heart failure. But that's where all this begins. In 2002, Mike Webster dies, and he winds up in Dr. Amalu's pathology lab in Pittsburgh. And Dr. Amalu makes this finding of hyperphosphorylated tau in Mike Webster's brain. And he says, oh, I found CTE. And now he starts his journey on what he thinks CTE is. But there is, I think, record in other cases that show Mike Webster had bizarre behavior in his later years. Didn't kill himself. But these are the conclusions that Dr. Mahler draws based on that study.
Are there other cases where experts have been allowed to testify to this? I guess my question is, was the failure here a failure of the experts specifically, or is there just no science?
The science isn't there yet. In fact, and this is covered in Dr. Gutierrez's decision, Judge Gutierrez's decision. If we look at the NFL class action from Eastern District of Pennsylvania, Judge Brody's decision approving the class action settlement and the Third Circuit's affirmance of that decision, she lays out very clearly, and this is called out expressly in Judge Gutierrez's decision. She lays out very clearly that the science behind CTE is nascent, her word, and it appears throughout that decision. I shouldn't say throughout, it appears in that decision and in the Third Circuit. The studies of CTE is new. We do not yet know or understand everything we need to know or understand about this. And she's approved the settlement because there's a good chance that if she didn't, the folks that brought the case wouldn't get any compensation. But that's spelled out, again, in Judge Gutierrez's decision. A number of experts testified, objectors to the settlement brought in expert testimony, and Judge Brody looked at all that. This is in 2015. I can find that, I believe.
So has Pop Warner specifically, have they faced a lot of litigation on this issue?
No, not a lot.
What's that?
Not a lot. We have one other case pending right now.
And that's in California as well, or?
Hawaii. And there was one case brought years ago, but this is it, three cases. And that's really what it comes down to, is the science is not there yet. We're still in the area of theory. You know, and there's another statistic that you find when you start looking into the literature. There have been more articles written about CTE in the last 5 years or so, 10,000 give or take, than there were in the last 100 years.
Well, there's been an avalanche of study. But CTE, I mean, I'm not sure how much that proves, because CTE wasn't really known 100 years ago, I don't think. But
true. But there's been an avalanche of study, and still they can't draw the dot. They can't connect the dots on this. Let me pull a couple of other things out for the court.
Are there studies with statistical evidence showing other causes? Neither of the two experts here did a differential type determination. And did defense offer any studies showing that other causes of the sort of self-destructive behavior in young people?
Yes, that was covered, and this is also in Judge Gutierrez's decision. Dr. Barr, the neuropsychologist that the defendants retained, covered some studies that describe the self-destructive tendencies of young men and the statistics associated with that. And he, based on those statistics and those studies, he draws the conclusion that it's more likely than anything else that that kind of behavior will happen independent of playing sports at that point in a young man's life. Just looking for something to address one of your questions, and I'm having a hard time locating it right now. But again, it comes down to what's reasonable probability versus what's possibility. And we're just not there. The evidence is not there. And plaintiff's experts essentially concede that. They can't tell you that Tyler Cornell would not have taken his own life if he didn't play Pop Warner football. They can't tell you that Paul Bright Jr. wouldn't have died in that motorcycle accident if he didn't play Pop Warner football. These are not substantial factors. And Judge Gutierrez correctly concluded that there is no tribal issue of fact with respect to specific causation for either of these young men. I'm happy to answer any other questions.
Well, apparently there are none. So if you wish to submit, I think we have your argument.
May I, Your Honor? I reserved a little bit of rebuttal.
Yes.
Your Honor.
Waiting for Mr. Corlato. Yes.
I'm sorry.
Okay, we're done. So yes, Mr. Finner.
Here's the Casey instruction for California. A substantial factor in causing harm is a factor that a reasonable person would consider to have contributed to the harm. So now we have the defense experts, Julian Bales, who is still associated with Pop Warner. His testimony has been that the subconcussive hits that young football players receive causes brain damage, period. And that brain damage can result in behavioral changes that increase the risk of suicide. We're talking about increased risk across the board. Mr. Corletto wants to hide behind the fact that this is relatively new science, but that doesn't stop the inquiry of, did Pop Warner do what it was supposed to do? Back in the time where Paul and Tyler played, they were on a practice by practice basis and game by game basis, accelerating their bodies into the opposing player on the other side of the line, day in and day out. They suffered hundreds, if not thousands, of concussive hits that resulted in brain damage. We're not simply talking about CTE. CTE is associated with suicidal behavior as well as brain damage. So I don't understand how we can say there's not enough science yet when Julian Bales, their own expert, says, yes, this type of brain injury causes an increased risk of suicide. We see from the asbestos cases that the time period is not important. All of these experts say that there's a latency period between the time that the damage occurs and the time that the symptoms start to manifest themselves. And with respect to this tau protein argument, it's a protein that builds up in response to injury. And in building up, it destroys the brain's ability to connect and therefore think the way, hopefully, us rational people think. And with that, thank you very much.
Thank you. I appreciate both sides' arguments. The case of Archie and Cornell versus Pop Warner, the old scholars, is submitted.